Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I'm back to moderate this very exciting session with Mr. G.P. Hinduja as well as Mr. A.P. Hinduja. Gentlemen, good to see you both here. I hope you, your families, and everyone at the Hinduja Group are indeed safe, healthy, practicing social distancing. Well, that's why the GPS is also being held virtually today, isn't it? Mr. G.P. Hinduja, let me start with you.
Yeah.
Remember when you were turning 75, there was all of this noise and news reports about how you were embracing spirituality. And I'm sure that spirituality today is coming in very handy. We all need to find a dose of spirituality to deal with the lockdown, the prolonged lockdown, the black swan, COVID-19. Give us a global perspective first, Mr. G.P. Hinduja. What's it been like in Europe?
You see, this is nothing new in my view. I'm very optimistic. In past, we have seen Spanish flu. We have seen World War I, World War II. We have seen the depressions in 2008. We have seen swine flu, plague, malaria, and all this. So, in my view, this will also disappear, but it has definitely affected a lot to the global economy, especially to the Western world, including European. I think Asians have managed better. Middle East has been affected very badly. But the worst part is, I first believe how we can save the lives. If lives are there, economy is going to improve, and economy will take off eventually. But we have to see the ray of the light. Although now China and Korea are, their cases have gone down, they have started productions, they have started running, but they are suffering from exports. And the opportunity has become for the African countries to accelerate their economy. In India, Prime Minister and his cabinet, the total society, community has really worked very hard to see how the cases can be little. Each and every businessman, industrialist, whether a small businessman or big businessman, has been doing so much for the society that it is an excellent example for the world to see. Whether it has been for the farmers supporting them, whether it has been for people who cannot even meet with their meals. And this is the Indian culture. And this culture is what is keeping us move forward and will definitely, the problem will get away and we will turn out to be successful. The economies go up and down. Already the economy had slowed down. Take for an example in United Kingdom. For 3.5 years, they were suffering. And suddenly this COVID-19 came in. And now it has been the worst. But the ease is much more than the isolation. Even now, the airports are open. I'm surprised to see that why they are not following this. But if you look at France, Germany, Italy, all these countries have been sufferers. The US is the biggest sufferer. It proves to everyone in the world that there is something else which is more powerful than any powerful politician. So it's a good lesson to learn. And in my view, this will open the door for something different and new in economy. Once things settle down, we'll be back on track and things will start moving. There is no reason to get depressed. We have to face it and see what best can be done. And at the moment, I can say that India has turned out quite well. controlling and handling the situation.
Absolutely. So, you know, this is a war that we're fighting on two fronts. One is the health front. We still don't have a medical breakthrough. But so far, India has also been grappling at the second front, which is the economy. And let me come to you now, Mr. Ashok Hinduja, on this front. I think every third day, there are speculations. Today will be the day that we will see a stimulus package. The government clearly doesn't want to fire the Brahma Shastra too early. But you know the saying, a stitch in time does save nine. Mr. Ashok Hinduja, have we already been a little late on that front as far as the stimulus package goes? Look at the United States. They've literally injected the size of the Indian economy to save the US economy. And when we are waiting and many will believe are procrastinating, what is it going to do to India's image as an economic destination? Mr. GP Hinduja is talking about opportunities. But sir, every country will be looking inward. Every country's finance minister is expected to come out with incentives to manufacture in their home country, provide jobs in their country, to provide stimulus in their country.
I agree with you that India has not taken a hasty decision on this. They should move very fast. But let me compliment to the RBI. RBI has moved very fast. And they have frequently in last 1 week, right from end of March till now, three different, in short intervals, they have come up with stimuluses, which has sustained the financial sector and the banking sector. Similarly, the government has also, Prime Minister Modi has done very well in lockout periods. Everybody has followed him. But he has to now also take care on the economic front, because last week they opened up certain industries, but again, unless the vendors are not supported, the vendors don't open up, the main industries will not start working on it.
To add what my brother said, you see, we were expecting the financial stimulus from the days of the budget to come. Unfortunately, nothing came in. Even now, the support what is being given is mainly to small businesses and SMEs, but nothing for the businessmen. In my view, it is the big business people who can create jobs, who can enhance the businesses, who can really give a lot of employment. And unfortunately, this step is not being taken. And I would request the government to take some very quick and fast steps to support the big business houses so that they can create bigger jobs and also to keep away from stress so that they are able to support not only the existing employees but to enhance their business.
Mr. GP Hinduja and Mr. AP Hinduja, you both have talked about banking. Both you gentlemen understand banking. You, of course, have interest when it comes to IndusInd Bank as well. I want to ask one question. If I look at the banking landscape, this is one sector, if you would allow me and indulge me to say, has been a bit obtuse, a bit stubborn when it comes to increasing credit uptake. You have 7 lakh crore rupees in the banking landscape right now, which is just lying there. Bankers are afraid to give credit, to give out money because they don't know if their NPAs are going to rise. It's also at a time when the banking industry's image has taken a big hit with what has happened in the last couple of months. So, Mr. GP Hinduja, if I could come to you, what is it going to take for bankers to do what they're supposed to do, which is to bank and to give credit?
You see, so far, I can say that the group has been involved over 100 years in banking and finance. My late father used to be the president of the Sharaf Association, and he was the one who introduced the Hundi system. And it worked very successfully, and there were no defaults any time. Now, to answer your question, no doubt in the group there is a lot of experience, there is a lot of expertise which is existing. But look how the state government has withdrawn the support from private banks. The private banks are the one which are really very practical, and they are the one who can support the business houses. In the public sector banks, the liquidity is there, but they are scared to give money because when they see the factories are closed and there is no businesses happening, they have to be careful and they have responsibility on their shoulders. So I would strongly recommend that the state government, especially Maharashtra, who withdrew all the deposits from the private banks, should start rethinking to have more deposits in the private banks rather than public sector banks who don't need it. And this will help. And also on NBFCs and financial institutions, all type of support and help will be given. As Ashok mentioned, we have to give credit to the governor of Reserve Bank, the way he moved fast, quick, and gave stimulus and support to the banking is incredible. I was not expecting, and I found him to be very practical and pragmatic.
Yes, he has certainly taken many measures, whether it was a moratorium. So of course, now the big ask is that there should be a waiver of interest during the prolonged lockdown, because it's the cost of credit is certainly rising as well. He's fired a big arrow by making sure of those TLTROs. But Mr. A.P. Hinduja, the fact is, we have also seen the banks don't want to take any risk at the moment. If you look at the last auction that took place, the idea of which was 50% would go to the SMEs, the backbone of this economy. 50% of it would also go to the NBFCs. Bankers are risk averse at the moment. The public is also scared. You just had a Franklin Templeton scare. There is a whole issue of credit as well. How are you going to grapple with all of this? Because without a strong banking system, without money, which actually exists in the form of liquidity, making its way and percolating down, the economy cannot pick up. Any of you two can take this.
It's a good question. In my school days, they used to teach us that whenever there is rain, you get supplies of umbrella. When the rain is not there, the umbrellas are there. And when the need is there, then it is not there. Now, public sector banks or private sector banks, it is their job and responsibility to save the businesses and to ensure how they can give help to the business people in difficulties to enhance their volume. But here in India, what I am seeing, whenever they think anything is in problem, instead of support, they become very constrained only for one issue, that tomorrow they should not be blamed. And if they are blamed, then the investigation starts. Now, unless the system and procedures are not corrected, we will always find these problems. You will find more and more business houses getting into difficulty. So the government should pay attention that what support they should give to the public sector bank, to the private sector bank, so that they can hold hands of businesses and make sure that when they are in difficulty, they support and provide help. And the bureaucratic processes should be cut off. The bureaucracy in this country was left by British people. They have modified, and in this country, still a lot has to be done to change the bureaucracy.
Let me add
to what GP said. You see, the banking system, normally they are, it's a chicken and egg. Unless the government doesn't give stimuluses to the industry, the bankers will not be free and comfortable to lend money. Okay. So unless they see that, yes, there is a support, the industry will start reviving, the bankers will also feel comfortable because the banks are here to lend money.
Right.
If they don't lend, they don't earn. If they leave money in the Reserve Bank, they don't earn. They hardly get 3.75%, which is nothing.
Let's move on from banking to the other sector that you brothers have a large presence in. Let's talk about auto. Ashok Leyland, commercial vehicles. So you want to give us a sense of how tough that has been? Everyone keeps talking about U-shaped recovery, V-shaped recovery, but in the midst of a lockdown, that is going to be one of the worst hit sectors. Obviously, nobody is going to be buying vehicles, and This is going to be the situation not just in India, but the large exports that you carry out, the presence that you have overseas, Mr. Ashok.
I totally agree with you that with this lockup, all the factories are closed. I can give the example of my own Ashok Leyland, where 5 to 6 plants have been closed down. Although they have given permission to start 3 or 4 of our plants, but we need vendor suppliers. If there are no suppliers, where do we go? But one good thing what Ashok Leyland has done is remarkable. Is the electric vehicle is on, BS6 is ready, as well as modular platform, so that different models can go, which is unique in this country. All this is ready. And Ashok Leyland has gone in many ups and downs, but has always been swimming well. But the total auto sector is really in trouble, whether it is passenger cars, whether it is commercial vehicle or buses. So they need much more stimulus. And Nitin Gadkari, the minister concerned, is a practical person and is also very, very on the top of the requirements. I'm sure some stimulus will come out for the auto sector to support and help them so that they can be back on track like this.
In fact, Mr. Ashok Hinduja, the auto sector has been asking for a while for how it needs a helping hand. There were some expectations it would happen in budget. I think we perhaps are going to need a brand new union budget whenever this lockdown does lift. Everything is going to have to be reworked. You're going to need stimulus measures, all of that. Mr. Ashok Hinduja, very quickly, if you we've heard what Nitin Gadkari has had to say. He's talked about it in a lot of web conferences and interviews. 3 big asks that actually help the auto sector and completely turn it around. And then we'll just quickly touch on oil after.
What they need is the support to the MSEs, medium and small industries, because they are totally more than 2,000 of them who are manufacturing different types of the parts which are supplied to the auto sector. And this is very important. So support coming from the government is very necessary. If you would like to add on this.
Yes, for example, in our own factory, we have 3,000 suppliers. And if these suppliers survive, then only the auto sector can survive. And the government has been telling since last 1.5 years that they are going to scrap the old models of 15 years old. Nothing has happened so far. In practicality, if you see the real stimulus which have to come up for industrialists and businessmen have yet to come. Once they are on, you will be surprised to see how the economy is booming.
Yes, it has a domino impact. In fact, one of the leading indicators that you have for the performance of an economy is, of course, commercial vehicles. At a time, sir, when we are looking that we may, there's a scare, as the IMF has said, we could return to the 1991 growth rate when India almost went bust, where we had to think out of the box. You're waiting for Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman to do the unimaginable. But where the government has a massive elbow room is when it comes to oil prices. So for an importer, and I know both of you will not agree, fantastic. We saw Brent futures turn so negative. This is the time where we should be importing more oil. GP Hinduja, AP Hinduja, if you could talk to me about how you've been navigating through these crude oil prices, the volatility. Obviously, investments are going to be down. It is every importer's dream. How has this been?
You are referring to the oil prices?
Yes, and Gulf oil in particular, I wanted to get you on.
Let me tell you. Had there not been a dispute between Russia and Saudi Arabia, the prices would not have fallen, number one. Two, nobody expected at that time that COVID-19 is going to come on them. When that came, it further hurt. And the demand has gone down. There is no extra warehousing. The maximum supplier is USA because their production cost is higher. In my view, once things settle down and we see the ray of light of stability, the prices will go back to $40 to $50. I have seen the crude oil prices from $2.40 to $11 to $30 to $70 to $100 and over $100. These are ups and downs, but this was all through cartel. How did OPEC get formed? The OPEC got formed only to make sure that the oil producing countries make more money. Today, who are the sufferers? The maximum sufferers are the ones who are dependent on oil production. That is Saudi Arabia, Qatar, UAE. Iran is under sanction, right. but they are surviving. They are surviving with their own agriculture and small scale industry. So something always comes up when things go wrong. And correct. This good learning lesson for producing, but it is in the advantage of the importers. But even today, India, it doesn't help them because there is no demand.
Correct. And in fact, we all are waiting to see that. We only have 3 strategic reserves that we can fill oil. It only lasts for 9.5 to 12 days. Gentlemen, I know you both have to go. I'm going to make this my final question. Which of the two you want to take it? There had come a time in recent past that whenever there would be a distressed asset, a big sale coming, the rumor was Hinduja Group is going to buy it. Whether it would be Air India, whether it was going to be even, BPCL privatization. I don't know how true those rumors were. If you would want to comment on that. And during COVID-19, the Black Swan, what are the Hinduja brothers doing for the conglomerate, dealing with it? Are you scaling back or are you seeing this as an opportunity to spread your wings and expand further?
Let me tell you, we brothers are interested in stress projects. But the system and the procedures which are there, they really deprive us from going into it. We were really on the line to save JET Air. Everything was agreed. But at the last moment, they said they want to go through NCLT route. Now, once you go through NCLT route, by that time, with the delay, the aircrafts, the traffic rights, everything goes away. How does it work? It doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Similarly, on Air India, we gave good thoughts and suggestions that what should be dropped from the tender so that it can work. Now, your second question was, what can be done and what the brothers are doing at the moment? Let me tell you, for the first time, we have been looking to the 48 countries we are existing in 12 verticals. Our each and every company, big or small, which we never get time ourselves to go into the depth of it. This morning to late evenings, we have presentation. We will look into it, what should be done, and we are working with strategists. What should be our strategy to the next step?
Okay, so that
before you leave, I want to tell you something which I have been emphasizing a lot. The OCIs and NRIs are the real wealth of India. You get $80 billion per year from non-resident Indians here. The total savings in Reserve Bank is $480 billion. Now, if some better rules and regulations are brought in to treat these investments at par with Indian investment, the money will flush in. We have good example of China. From 1984 to 1997, they were only dependent on the China, these Chinese, who really helped with their own funds to build the economy and also bring other investors to do. Now, right. Similarly, the NRIs and OCIs, they may be living abroad. They may love their host country, but their heart is in homeland. And they always like to see what best they can do for India. But they have to be given red carpet treatment so that when their investment comes, they don't have to struggle from state to center, center to state. Why don't they form a state and center joint commission that when a decision is being taken, the state and center gets resolved it themselves, life will become much easier. And also, the NRIs should get encouragement to bring in the foreign other investors also. Besides this, we can have offshore accounts like Singapore, and India can really get the most multinational groups in the country. With that,
right,
geographically, India is well situated between East and West. And it can
correct
create a new scene and give a big boost to the economy. And whatever is the suffering from this COVID-19, you can see the acceleration. I'm talking from my practicality and from my experiences of the last 60 years I have in my life.
That's certainly food for thought and a great proposal that I think the Narendra Modi government must consider. It's always a pleasure having the Hinduja group and the Hinduja brothers together in one frame, interacting, ideating, brainstorming. Thank you so much, both of you, for taking the time out and being a part of this event. Thank you very much.
For inviting us, and wish you good health. And also, Karuna Devi blesses you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.